mentioned, we are launching the 2020 season today. We have a lot of really exciting things going on this season. We have our every month between February and October, which we started last year doing the every month session, and that was really well received. So we're going to keep that up for sure. And starting in February and every other month, we will feature Matt and Mike from the Plant Disease and Insect Clinic, who will share their vast knowledge of the pest and plant disease issues and share with us tips on how to identify plants, identify pests, and how to diagnose plant diseases, and just keep us up to date on what's going on across the state. And then in the other months, March, May, July, and September, we have guest speakers who will give a presentation on a feature topic. And we will also have Matt and Mike join us for some quick bolos, be on the lookout for. So every time you'll get to hear about what's current in the state. But for our guest speakers we have lined up this year, next month we have Elsa Youngstead and Meredith Favre, apologies, and they will be talking about how to operate a bee hotel. So particularly the nesting habitat for mason bees and some of the other bees that will nest in cavities and in straws and things like that. We will learn how to build and maintain those bee hotels. In May, Sam Marshall will be joining us and talking about larval host plants for Lepidopterum. So those are the butterflies and the moths. Then in July, Kira Sims is going to join us with tips on weed management for home landscapes and gardens. And in September, Lucy Bradley and Kathleen Moore will be with us to talk about finding the right plant for the site and particularly how to use the plant toolbox to do that. So really exciting things going on this season, and you can always visit the website to explore that schedule. And I'll drop some of these links in the chat box in a few minutes. Other things, of course, we record all of our sessions. So if you miss a session or you want to go back and review, you can find us on YouTube. You can visit the playlist and find all of the recordings since 2009. Almost every session was recorded. There are a few that weren't, but they're almost all there. And if you're like me and you kind of tend to remember things by dates or when they happened, we do have an index of recordings that is chronological. So if you want to go and see a list by year and by month within the year, we have that index of recordings. And we also have our table of contents. And I want to show you that really quickly because that's quite a neat, tool that we're really fortunate that Mike Munster keeps up for us. This shows all of the disease and pests that were discussed during a given webinar. So if you are specifically looking for information on a specific webinar and you can't find what you need, you're not looking for the guest speaker. So the guest speakers are shown up on our index, but you're looking for those pest and disease issues that were covered. You can come here to the index of recordings, to the table of contents and search it. And the easiest way to search it is to use Control F. So if you're on a PC, you use Control F. If you are, there you go. So if you hit Control F, a little box will come up. If you're on a Mac, it's Command F, I believe, F for find. And just put the term that you want to search for. So if we look for something like black rot, we can see that it's been covered a lot. We have 18 places where it's popped up, and you can push the arrows. I'm hoping that that little box is popping up and that you guys can see that. But as we push the arrows, we see it moves through. We see June 2012. We see October 2012, so black rot's obviously something we see a lot of and that comes up quite often. There it is in February 2016, if we keep moving through, October 2018. So you can search for things like that to see when they were discussed and then go to either the playlist or to the index of recordings and find that episode and play it to learn more about that issue. And the question in the chat box is the table of contents viewable by the public? It is. So from our main Plants, Pests, and Pathogens webpage, where you go to find the current season, you can get to the, let me go down to the bottom actually, it's from the bottom. you can get to the table of contents here from the bottom. So table of contents is linked there, as is the index of recordings and our YouTube playlist. And our season for this year. And this, of course, also is where links will be added for our recordings from this year. I'll show you really quickly too. So the index of recordings is linked both at the top and the bottom of the page. And with our index of recordings, it's really similar. You can go up from the top and go to a specific year if you want to see who the guest speakers were. That's the index of recordings, just mainly focuses on the guest speakers. But you can also use the Control F function here to see, was there ever a presentation on native plants? Of course there was, because I gave it. That's why I chose it. I knew it was there. So you can search for specific topics like that if you want to see we ever had a guest presenter give a certain presentation. All right. I don't see any other questions in the chat, so we'll go back to the slides. So I do really encourage you to spend some time exploring the resources that are available to help you find plant pests and pathogens recordings and find the information that's been covered. And the great thing about the table of contents now is, since it is posted as a Google Doc that's posted online and it is updated, each time Mike updates it, the table of contents you view is also automatically updated. All right, that brings us to our new feature. So one thing we've decided to do this year, add this year to Plants, Pests, and Pathogens, based on your feedback from the folks who took the survey and made suggestions, is to make our Plant of the Month a feature each month, which we did add it last year, but it was just a little bit kind of random as far as basically it was what was blooming in my yard that I had a picture of. So that's how we learned about our Plant of the Month. But we decided to be a little more intentional this year, and we are going to focus on landscape plants that do more by feeding birds and pollinators, because we had lots of requests to learn more about birds and pollinators and plants that support them. So every month we will focus on a plant that pretty much grows all across North Carolina. Most of them are typically native to most of North Carolina. And these plants are available, especially if you're willing to look at some specialty nurseries. It's not necessarily something you might get at Lowe's or Home Depot, but they are commercially produced and available if you look around a bit. But they're things that need to be more widely known. So we're focusing on those plants that are being propagated and produced, but maybe aren't everywhere yet. So you might need to look a little at some specialty nurseries or nurseries and garden centers that feature a really wide range of plants to find some of these. So that will be our Plant of the Month, and then we are going to add a Weed of the Month. So Weed of the Month was another one that we got a lot of feedback that people were interested in learning more about weeds and weed ID. So we are going to feature each month a weed that you're likely to be asked about in the coming week. So this is a current weed that's either blooming and people are seeing, or it's prickly or something like that, and it's catching people's attentions. And so, of course, we have henbit for February, because it's just starting to bloom and people really, really notice it when it comes into bloom. And so for our Weed of the Month, we are looking for weeds that occur all across North Carolina, and we will include some management tips. So let's jump into it. So this is our Plant of the Month. And this month for February, it is spicebush or Lindera benzoin. This is a native deciduous shrub that occurs pretty much throughout the eastern United States and all across North Carolina, though it's not quite as common maybe in the southeast. It occurs more in pockets. In the landscape, it's a nice shrub. It's kind of like you would use it like most deciduous shrubs. It blooms really early in the spring. So in my yard, it's not quite blooming yet, but the buds are definitely enlarging. So it will be in bloom very soon, especially when we get these little pockets of warm weather. It'll grow about 6 to 8 feet tall. If you have it in the shade, it will tend to get a little more open and a taller. So if you keep it in the sun, like most plants, it's more compact and more rounded in shape. It will grow in both sun or shade. It's extremely tolerant of sun or shade exposure. The more sun it's in, though, the more important it is that it has moist soil. In shady sites, it can tolerate more drought or drier conditions. But it typically naturally occurs in floodplains, so it is very tolerant of flooding or could be used at the edge of a pond or somewhere that seasonally floods. So you can see in the picture the little tiny blossoms that line the stem in late winter. It will also have yellow fall color and then lovely red berries that ripen in late summer. So it's actually pretty early for those berries to start ripening. And I think I didn't quite mention yet, the first bullet up there is it is in the laurel family, the Lauraceae. And like many plants in the laurel family, it's very aromatic. So when you crush the leaves up or when you scrape the bark on the stem, it has a distinct scent that's sometimes described as wintergreen. So it's quite a nice scent. And these are the berries. Sometimes as late as July, they'll start coloring up. And then they go from green to bright red. Often the leaves will start to turn yellow early, say even in September, and you've got the yellow leaves and the red berries, and it's quite pretty. But the really great thing about both those leaves and those berries is they support some pretty amazing wildlife. So the berries actually are really high in fat and are considered one of the most valuable food sources for migrating birds in the southeast. So as those birds are making those flights, they need a lot of energy, high fat berries, and spicebush provides that. But it is one of these plants that has separate male and female plants. So if you are gonna plant spicebush, then you probably want to buy at least a couple of plants to make sure you get a male and a female, because you do need both for fruit sets. And only the females will have the berries. Those early blooms are great for bees, which will, and other pollinators, which are out hungrily looking for nectar at this time of year. So anything that's early blooming that attracts pollinators is a real resource, a real important resource for our pollinators. And then you can see this amazing picture. This is actually a caterpillar. And this is one of my favorite things about spicebush is you get these beautiful spicebush swallowtail caterpillars. So you will find them. You actually don't see them just sitting out on the leaf. They will spin some silk and roll the leaf around themselves. So what you see is some of the leaves rolled over. And if you pull them open, you'll see this caterpillar inside. In fact, on this picture, you can see a little bit of that silk residue, that kind of shiny halo effect around the caterpillar is that silk reflecting light. So as you can see, this caterpillar has some pretty cool markings. And if we look close up, it looks like eyes. So eyes on its back. So if you were a bird flying over and looking down at this, you would think, man, that's pretty scary. It's a snake, or that's not something I want to tangle with. And you would leave that caterpillar alone. So it is a defensive strategy to have these pretty cool markings. And I see Dan Mason sharing that his grandmother used to make tea with the stems. And I do believe it has some traditional medicinal uses. You know, we're not saying it is medicinal or it will cure anything, but if you go online and read about it, you can read about some traditional uses of it like that. So it's got these amazing caterpillars that then mature into the spicebush swallowtail. So it looks similar to some of the other swallowtails, like the black swallowtail, which feeds on parsley. This one actually, though, will only lay its eggs on members of the laurel families, particularly spicebush and sassafras is also the native one we tend to find it on in our region. So I really encourage everyone to consider adding spicebush to their landscape. With it being really tolerant of sun and shade, it's something that is likely that everybody would have a place in their yard to grow one. And even if you just get one bush and you get a male and you don't have a female, you don't have the berries, you still have the leaves. So you'll be feeding the spicebush swallowtails. And that brings us to our brand new feature, our weed of the month. Answer a question in the chat. So when buying, how can you tell male from female if not blooming? So that's a great question from Stacy, and the answer is you cannot. So the only way you can tell these shrubs that have, or trees that have separate male and female plants, either is when they're blooming, inspect the blossoms and look very, very closely, often requires a hand lens at the reproductive parts, to see which is male and which is female. And then of course, the other thing is in fall or late mid summer to late summer when the berries are ripening, if it has berries on it, you know it's female. So that's really the way the only way to know. There's nothing about the leaf characteristics or anything else that you can tell. Although with spicebush, if you're really familiar with it, the flower buds, you know, can help give it away. I think the male flower buds may be a little larger. All right. So, yeah. So if you're going to be buying spicebush, you might want to do it either when they're in bloom or in the summer, late summer when the berries are present. So you can tell which is male and female. All right, I don't see any other questions popping in the chat, but if something comes to mind, please add it and we'll get to it. So this is our weed of the month, and actually it's two weeds. They're close cousins, and they often grow together, so I included both of them, and we're looking at henbit and dead-nettle. And they are really common weeds. They're from Europe and Asia. They've been introduced to the United States. And they grow just about everywhere. You can see them in fields, you can see them in lawns, you can see them in gardens, pretty much any disturbed area, you're likely to find both henbit and dead nettle or one or the other. They are really quite pretty when they're in bloom, which is why people notice them. They have these purpley red flowers. And one of the main differences when they're in bloom, you can see is the henbit, the flowers, are a little more obvious. They stick out from the leaves a little more. On henbit, the leaves themselves are sessile, so they don't have stems. They're attached directly to the stem without a little petiole. Whereas with dead nettle, the leaves do have that petiole, so they're lifted out a little more from the stem, and the flowers are kind of interspersed among the leaves. But also on dead nettle, the leaves that are up at the top with the blooms tend to have this purplish blush, so it adds color as well. So from a distance, when you have either henbit or dead nettle or both of them together, you just see this purple, just this purple haze. You can see whole fields of purple, pastures of purple, lawns of purple. And we tend to get a lot of questions about them as they're coming into bloom, which they've already started blooming, and definitely in the next few weeks will bloom. Be blooming much more strongly. They are in the mint family, and if you're familiar with the mint family, those plants have square stems. So if you pick one of these and roll it between your fingers, it'll go bump, 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 because you're hitting those square stems, the edges of the square stems rather than round stems. And also they do have maybe I should call it an odor. If you crush the leaves, it is herbal. It is herbaceous scented. It is not minty. So they don't smell like mint, but there is a smell there, kind of like Creeping Charlie, which is another one of their very close relatives. Unlike many things in the mint family, though, these are annuals. They're cool season annuals. So they grow in the cool time of the year. The seeds germinate in the fall or in the winter, and they've been growing through the winter. You may not have noticed them, but now that they come in bloom, that's when people really say, all of a sudden, I have all these weeds. They were there all through the winter, but they just became noticeable because of the blooms. And it is one of the first of our cool season annuals to really come out and bloom, and it's also one of our first cool season annuals to die. So after they bloom, they pretty much die really quickly. And sometimes when they die off, that catches people's attention too. It's like, especially in the lawn, they might think something's wrong with their lawn because they have all these weeds that are dying. And they will often get powdery mildew right after they finish blooming. So you'll see them covered in that white powdery mycelium. As annuals, they do spread by seed. So a lot of the management is focused around preventing the seed from germinating. We'll talk about that in just a minute. But like I said, you pretty much can find them anywhere, and they are a little more common in moist soil. So moist, rich soil, they're really happy, but they will grow anywhere, including dry sites. Then from a management standpoint, I know this picture isn't great, but it's a picture I took of bees foraging on henbit. It is a great bee plant. So I would definitely say if you can tolerate where they're growing, if they're not, you know, causing too much of a nuisance, just let them grow and bloom and let the bees enjoy them because they are a valuable early nectar source. So if you can let them go, or maybe let them bloom some and then pull them up as the blooms are fading so the bees have some benefit from them. But if they're in a site that you need to manage, you really have to think about the life cycle of these cool season annuals. And this is true for all cool season annuals, whether you're talking about henbit or chickweed or many of the weeds that are becoming prominent this time of year. Before they actually germinate, so we're talking about last summer, during the summer, late summer, August, September, making sure you have a really good layer of mulch down so that if there are seeds in the soil, they're buried beneath that mulch, they're in the dark, they're not getting exposed to light, so they're not hopefully going to be prompted to germinate. Or the use of pre-emergent herbicides for broadleaf weeds is another way that you can manage them. And depending on whether you're in a lawn situation or a landscape situation, the products you use would be different. So you need to do some research on those products. If the weeds have already germinated though, mulch isn't gonna help, pre-emergents aren't gonna help. So when we're looking into the fall and winter, really your only option is to pull them up. So hand weed if you're not gonna use herbicides. If you are going to use herbicides, there are several post-emergent herbicides, you know, things that have glyphosate will work, but you have to be really careful with your application because they're non-selective. And then in lawns, there are your products with 2,4-D and your 2,4-D and other herbicides that will control this weed, especially when it's small. That's really key, is getting it when it's small and actively growing. And those 2,4-D and dicamba type products don't harm most grasses, but definitely always check the label. Then at this time of the year, when people really start seeing it and asking you about it, it is flowering. It is really too late. Herbicides aren't going to be terribly effective because it is fully mature. It's not really actively growing. The herbicides are, you know, just not going to have a lot of action. And plus, once it's already in bloom, even if you sprayed it and it died, there's quite a good chance some of the seeds are mature enough that even if the plant dies, it leaves seeds behind. So at this time of year, and especially within the coming months, as it really gets into full bloom, I would focus on hand weeding it in areas you want to prevent reseeding. And don't just pull the weeds and leave it laying on the ground because the seeds will be there. Or in some cases continue to ripen on the plant even though it's been pulled. So make sure when you're out weeding and pulling those weeds, you have a bucket with you or you have a wheelbarrow and you're putting the weeds in and taking them away to a compost pile or somewhere where it would be okay if they left some seeds behind. So that is our weed for the month, and I will send out some follow-up information that'll have a few more links. You can learn more about these, and I also, in just a few minutes, add some links to the chat. These, both Lindera, our plant of the month, and henbit and dead-nettle, our weed of the month, are posted on, are part of the Extension Gardener plant toolbox, so you can find them there, along with information about thousands of other plants and hundreds of other weeds that are common in North Carolina. And with that, I'm going to add those links to the chat, and I'm going to turn it over to Matt Bertone and Mike Munster, who are here to share with us what's going on in the world of plant disease and pest at this time of year.
All right. Thanks, Charlotte. Everyone can hear me, I hope. And I will be starting off today with Mike following me. And thanks for all the organization on the PPP website or page, because now people can find things. And I actually mentioned something that will be useful, that'll be useful for. Okay, let's see. Okay, can everyone see this? I'm assuming, hopefully. All right.
Yes, yeah, great. We see osmanthus.
Wait, great, okay, this is from my yard, of course, as we do. Basically, I don't know what they're showing exactly, but you can probably see a little bit of brown foliage there. And here's a closer up. And I just wanted to highlight this because this is the time of year when we will see some freeze damage to new growth. So of course, lately the winters are a little warmer. Things start to grow a little bit. My osmanthus does this many years recently, where it'll start to put out new growth when it's warm in the winter. And then the other day we got snow and freezing and quickly killed the tips of this osmanthus. Now it does help me because I don't have to prune it as much, but it's not a great thing to happen. And we'll hear a little bit more about that maybe later on. Okay, but getting into critters. So it has also been wet. As you all know, it's been, I don't know how it is across the state, but it's been a rainy couple days here. We've had a couple weeks of heavy rains, flooding. Here's me walking on campus. You can see actually the very edge of my umbrella right here. And, you know, lots of standing water. There's standing water in the turf. There's mulch being washed away and standing water in these garden beds on campus and I'm sure everywhere else. So what does that mean and why am I mentioning that? Well, flooding and lots of rain cause a lot of issues. And so we can blame it on the rain, some of these crazy critters. Now, this is one of the most famous internet photos of critters avoiding flooding. This is major floods in the Southeast, I think. And somebody snapped this shot many years ago, and I could not find out who snapped it. So, but if you look online, these are all these critters avoiding the flooding. So excessive rains can cause some critters to behave differently. Flooding of the soil can drive these organisms out of their usual habitats. And so you get massive amounts of these creatures seen. And actually, excessive drought can also cause similar behaviors. They are migrating to either find more moisture, or in the cases recently, they are trying to avoid excess moisture. Of course, many of these organisms prefer moist habitats, but once it starts to flood, oxygen gets depleted, they drown very easily. Many people think of things like earthworms coming out in the rain, and they do. Again, earthworms breathe and they need air, so when it starts to rain excessively, the ground gets saturated, the earthworms can't breathe as well, they come up to the surface, and so that's when you see them. But we have seen a lot of things lately based on all this rain. Okay, so first thing, millipedes. So millipedes are these worm-like organisms, worm-like arthropods, they're myriapods. They have numerous legs and two pairs of legs per segment. So each segment should have two pairs of legs. They're fairly slow-moving vegetarians or fungus feeders, leaf litter feeders. But in these high amounts of rain situation, you're going to get a lot of these millipedes moving out of the soil and to other areas. Now, several species may be involved. In fact, if you've seen this previous picture, we get some giant millipedes here and some smaller ones. But the most common one I see is the greenhouse millipede, Oxus gracilis. And I'll show you that a little bit more specifically in a second. Now, what happens is these will crawl up into homes, up onto foundations. They're basically avoiding all that moisture. Those that come into homes end up then having the opposite happen where they're too dry, they die, dry up, curl up, and can sometimes leave a little bit of an odor. A lot of these millipedes produce chemicals for defense because they're not venomous and they're not very fast. And so predators are avoiding them because of the chemicals they produce. That also makes them have a distinct musky odor that you sometimes smell in basements or crawl spaces, places like that. So here are some pictures of some millipedes that have been submitted over the years. You know, you can see how moist and this situation is on the right, and you can see all these millipedes climbing up to higher ground to find to avoid this water. And when they get into homes, you can see they're curled up like this. They die, they dry up, and they curl up. And again, they could be a nuisance. Now, when they get into homes, they can be either removed from the home and let outside. They can also be just vacuumed up. You can wait for them to die and dry up, but they won't survive in homes very long, especially where it's too dry. They may survive a little longer in damp basements, but if it's dry in the rest of the house, they're not gonna survive. Now, how do you identify this millipede specifically? So again, this is one of the most common millipedes around. They're about 3/4 to 1 inch long, 3/4 of an inch to 1 inch long, shiny and brown. They have a groove across each body segment, very distinct. It's the only ones that you'll see around that have this basically. And there are these flanges on the sides of the of each segment. So they have this little kind of, it's called a paranoda. And these are, like I said, these little flanges on the sides. I have a question, in a home, do they find food to sustain themselves? No, typically not, especially if it's dry. Moisture is the most limiting factor for these. And so if it's in a basement that's really moist and damp, they may find food sources, but it's going to be decaying matter, molds, things like that. If it's very clean and you don't have, you know, there's not a lot of food sources and it's moist, they probably won't stay there very long. And then in most of the house is just too dry for them to survive. So they may be in there for a little bit, but they're going to die fairly quickly. And they lose a lot of moisture pretty quickly. But good question. Okay. So that's the most common millipede we see during the rains. So if you see this crawling on the foundations, things like that, no need to spray. When it starts to dry out, they're going to leave. You can remove them manually, again, from homes. But there's really no chemical control needed. And in fact, sometimes when it's not raining out and chemicals are used, they may avoid those and start crawling away into other parts where you don't want them, or from mulch and such. Okay, springtails. We've been getting a lot of springtails. I'm not going to go over them in detail. You can actually see the previous Plants, Pests, and Pathogens episode on March 2017. So that's a good note to use that table of contents and those the previous recordings. So I did a whole section on Calambula, the springtails, but these are small insects in quotes because they're not even technically considered insects. They're considered non-insect hexapods, which means they have six legs, but they're a fairly primitive group that is not a true insect. Very common in soil and among grass and those types of situations. Many of them have hydrophobic bodies, meaning they float. Now these are mostly dead, but when you're flooding, you will actually see lots of them floating. And from afar, because they're so tiny, they look like powder on the top of the water. So it looks like somebody sprinkled some kind of like pepper or some little bits of fuzz on the water surface because they're all on top of there. Some, while they were living, are actually very closely associated with freshwater. For instance, Pudura aquatica gets its name because it is closely associated with freshwater, where you find them, thousands of them in groups on puddles, on ponds, places like that, especially where it's very slow or still water. You'll see this basically this bluish gray powder all over the water. If you look up close, you're going to see multiple springtails. Ants. So this time of year, it's a little less active for ants, but during the warmer parts of the year, then when they're more active, the rain may push them out of the soil where they have their nests, and this will dry them out to drier areas. So they may swarm, or they may come crawl up the houses, they may crawl into houses. And so if you're seeing a lot of ants, again, make sure it's either not too dry out. If it's too dry, they may be searching for water in your home. Or if it's too wet, they're avoiding drowning. And the best ants that avoid drowning are fire ants. Let's see if this works. Okay, so this is Adrian Smith, a good friend of mine down at the museum downtown here in Raleigh. He's a great myrmecologist, so an ant researcher, but he also does great time-lapse videos and slow-motion videos. I've been working with him on some projects, but he made this really amazing video of fire ants making rafts. And because fire ants come from Argentina in the floodplains, they are very used to flooding, and they basically, when the nests are flooded, these ants move into big masses and float away and reestablish in other places. So don't wade through floodwaters where there's lots of fire ants. I'm sure they're not very happy at that moment. So anyway, this is what happens sometimes. And unfortunately, we have a lot of fire ants in North Carolina, as everyone knows. Okay. Now, I got a message from Deborah Dillian, I think is on this. She forwarded me a message. These larvae were on three sides of my house this AM, east, north, east, south, a lot of larvae. I clean up almost a 5-gallon bucket full. Well, that's a lot. That's a lot of these critters. And we actually got several samples this spring so far of this with the heavy rains. And I actually came across one while walking across campus. Unfortunately, I killed my memory card and was not able to share the pictures of that specific specimen. But these are crane fly larvae. So crane flies are also called mosquito hawks. They're in the order Diptera. They're true flies in the family Tipulidae. And the ones that are most commonly seen in these cases are the genera Tipula and maybe Nephrotoma. And those are two more terrestrial species or genera that have these larvae that are called leather jackets. And I'll show you why in a second. They're very diverse and in many habitats, these crane fly larvae in many of them are aquatic or subaquatic, but many are also found in lawn or pasture soils. There they'll feed on detritus, decaying matter, but they can actually also sometimes become turf pests where they feed on the roots of grasses. So they can be a big pest sometimes, but just because you're seeing a lot of them does not mean that you're gonna have turf issues. They are often feeding on the decaying matter in the soil. But they grow up to be these, but when they're young, they look like this. They look like these leathery, brown, gray, worm-like critters. This is another photo that was submitted recently. Again, the floods and the rain are driving these out of the soil, and they crawl to avoid it. They're not crawling after your house. They're not trying to eat you or anything like that. And if we get a closer look, this is a different type of crane fly, but very similar. So crane fly larvae are brownish gray, leathery looking, like I said. Again, the name leather jacket has been used for them. They can retract their head inside their body. So here's where the head region is. And they actually have kind of half of a head. And they'll stick it out a little bit when they're crawling, but they can retract it back into their body a good bit. Another thing, and this is common for all fly larvae, at least true legs, they never have legs at all. So they do look very worm-like. Crane fly larvae, there are a couple aquatic ones that have kind of fleshy legs on their abdomen, but almost all the ones, basically all the ones that you're going to see in turf or soils or in more terrestrial habitats are going to be completely legless. No legs in the front or the back.
This I was watching a video from the extension gardener stuff. Okay, go ahead. That's all right. Go ahead.
So one of the interesting things is actually, though, if you look at the other end of the body, the rear end looks a lot like a face or some kind of weird mask. It actually looks like googly eyes. It's kind of cute, but that's actually the rear end. And those eyes are not eyes, but they are spiracles. They are the breathing holes on the back of the larva. So crane fly larvae will often have little appendages or little spikes, little almost look like a star shape, but these huge eye-like spiracles on the back. So it's a good way to tell when you have crane fly larvae. Again, the very thick skin, grayish brown, head that retracts, and these face-like rears. That's a good way to know that you have a crane fly larva. Okay. Now another treat, another video. Okay. These were sent in to. Ooh, fun. All right. So these are not insects, but these are horsehair worms. Now, horsehair worms are something maybe not everybody knows about, but they are in the phylum, actually, Nematomorpha. And they're also called Gordian worms due to the knot of the same name. So there was the legend was that Alexander the Great visited a town that had this knot that was supposedly impossible to untie. And whoever did untie it would rule Asia. And he came along and basically just sliced it open with a sword and said, "I won." And basically then I guess that was good enough to conquer Asia. So apparently it's a term for an unsolvable problem that's basically solved with brute force or something like that. So, and actually you could see in the previous one that there is the, here's that knot. So they often do form knots, but these are really interesting worms. So they are aquatic, freshwater aquatic worms with an insect host as part of their life cycle. So here's the life cycle over here. Sorry about the credit. I couldn't find exactly who it was, but there's a signature down there. But basically, what you saw were the full-grown adult worms in freshwater. These actually came from somebody's house from where they were collecting rainwater. What happens is these adults will mate, lay eggs. Their eggs hatch into a larva, which then sinks to the ground, to the substrate, and gets eaten by insects, aquatic insects like fly larvae, mayfly larvae, things like that. Now it sits as a cyst inside that insect, and when the insect emerges from the water and then gets eaten by a predator or an omnivore, it will then develop into the big worm that we saw. Once it's done, basically then, and actually this most often happens in crickets, ground beetles, and mantises, but can be other groups. I've even seen a video of a spider that got sprayed with a can of Raid or something like that, and one of these emerged from it. But basically what happens, crickets are very often the host, and say a midge larva consumes this, it flies out to the shore, dies, the adult midge dies out on the shore. A cricket comes along, eats it because it's an omnivore, it gets infected, and this huge worm then develops inside. What most interesting thing about the biology is that these worms actually then cause the cricket or the mantis or the ground beetle to search for water. So it makes it a zombie, it makes it run and jump into water even though it doesn't want to, and once in the water, the worms emerge in mass. Now, one thing to note very much is that they are not a parasite of humans. There are a couple bits of literature out there saying with accidental infections, but they're not really an infection. Somebody drank water that was contaminated, something like that, or drank the worm, but it is not a parasite of humans. These are only insect parasites. And looking a little closer, they're relatively large, about 2 to 4 inches, but very thin. Now they are closely related to, they're actually the sister group to nematodes, but they are not in the same group as nematodes. The body is tan or brown, sometimes cream colored. Males, and they have these distinctive ends. So the front looks like a little cap, almost a blunt tip. And the rear actually is a clasping organ to mate with the females. And so you do have males and females. The males are much more active and they search out females to reproduce. All right, great. Everybody's ready for lunch now. Okay, so that's all I have for, actually a couple other things for the rain. So you may see other critters that are either associated with moist habitats or live in the soil when it's dry and emerge when it's raining too much. So slugs, snails, and isopods are again like the millipedes where they're in those habitats. When it's too flooded, they will exit there. They will crawl up or slither up foundations of houses, things like that. I've also seen, especially in the summer, when the white grubs, especially like this green June beetle larva that actually crawl on their backs, they're present in lawns or fields. And when excessive rain and flooding happens, they emerge and will mass migrate away from there. And I've actually seen situations where they will all end up inside of a swimming pool and you have hundreds of dead larvae that crawled in there accidentally. So if you're seeing these mass migrations or massive amounts of crawling critters that are usually associated with moist, you know, leaf litter and mulch, then make sure you know, make sure to note whether there's been a lot of rain or of a lot of drought. A lot of rain is much more of an issue, and this will temporarily cause this influx of these critters to come around your home. And so once the rains go away, they should return. So there's no need to, you know, go spray everything or worry about it. But note that it is weather related. Okay. All right, so quiz. Let's see. What is affecting this apple tree? And I'll put the survey up in a second. Just poll. So is it a fungal disease, insects, bacterial disease, or nothing? And so we will do this. I'm going to launch the poll. Let me know what you think. Okay, we'll give it to about 40 seconds. How about that? I don't know if you can see the timer, but got about 10 seconds left. All right. All right, we'll end the poll there. Okay. So can everybody see these results? I'm hoping so. All right. So a lot of people answered fungal disease, a few with insects, few bacterial, and D, nothing. A few with that. Okay. So, everybody see the results and satisfied with that? Okay.
Yeah, we see.
Great, great. Okay, I'm going to close those now. All right, the answer is actually insects. So, the key word here was what is affecting this apple tree. So that even though you see this mat of fungus there, the fungus is not actually a disease and it's not actually affecting the tree. And so I want to talk very briefly about felt fungus. Okay, well, let me go back first. I have a question here. Is excess rain also making moles and voles more active, more noticeable at the surface? Ooh, that I don't know exactly. I imagine it would a little bit. It also may make the soil more soft for them to burrow through much more easily. But I would imagine that they also want to avoid the excess moisture, the flooding, things like that. I actually don't know much about their behavior, though, in flooding. But that's a good question, and I will take a look at that. Although, can everybody see that? It says privately as far as the chat. Anyway, I will look into that actually. That's a very good question. Okay, so back to felt fungi. So felt fungi are really kind of interesting fungi. They are in the genus Septobasidium, and they only grow on armored scale insects. So in this family Diaspidae, so that's why this is really an insect issue. So the insects are affecting the tree, the fungus is growing on the insects, so the fungus is really a sign that you have insects. It's, again, not a pathogen to the plant, but indicate the armored scale infestation, and actually it can be difficult. It's hard to see the actual armored scales on here or here, or if we go back on here. But some of these were actually probably San Jose scales. They're kind of under the bark. They're a little bit camouflaged. So until you see that fell fungus, you really may not know that you have a scale insect infestation. You can see it's sometimes black, and I think this is an early stage. So it's a little blacker and rougher in small patches. And then as it gets bigger, it makes this tan, felt-looking fungus. Now, ways to know that it's not a disease are if you were to scrape away the bark underneath, you'll see that the plant material is still green, it's still healthy, there's no disease or decay in there. You should also then look for the actual scales. And so in these cases, and we've actually been seeing a lot, we've been seeing a lot of this on those apple samples this year. And I think what happens is that once the foliage is gone over the winter, people start seeing the felt fungus more. But we most often see it on black gum or Nyssa, oaks, apples this year particularly, but they've been on other hosts too. I think this one, I don't know if it's actually that holly. I've seen it on redbud, but basically any plants that get armored scales, which are very common on lots of different plants, can have felt fungi. And one thing to note specifically is I found my first one ever for myself that was on a leaf. Most often they're going to be on the branches where there are existing colonies, there's persisting colonies. But because this is a camellia, and I think because the leaves last a lot longer than other plants, there were a lot of T-scales all over. You can see all these T-scales all over the camellia leaf. And then this big patch of felt fungus. And if you look closer, you see the fungus right here and some structures, which I'm sure Mike knows what they're called. Maybe, obviously he does, but I'm not sure if he'll answer. Mike, you there?
I'm here, and I don't know the name of those.
Yep,
they are typical, or at least not uncommon, in the septobacillium to have those in the layer, in that underlying layer of the fungal tissue.
Okay. Yeah, when I was looking at this drawing by Couch right here, I was wondering if those things were like the filaments, that something coming out of the top of each scale. And then I wonder if there are associated scales under here, but maybe not. So I don't know fungi that well, but I do know when you see felt fungus that you've got a scale issue. Okay, so I'm going to wrap up with my part. Is it parasitic on the scales or saprophytic? That is a good question, and I don't think anybody exactly knows. It definitely, there is some argument as to whether the scales die and then it feeds on it, or whether they actually kill the scales, or whether it's a mutualism where it protects the scales and some live and some get eaten and sacrificed. I don't think we know exactly what the case is, but oftentimes when I scrape away the fungus, the scales are dead. And do not look very happy. So I'm not sure how much the felt fungus is actually affecting it. So, and control suggestions. So that was another private chat. So control recommendations, it all depends on the plant and the host and the time of year. So you can look those up online. We have some information on armor scales through our website and through fact sheets. But knowing the specific host and the type of scale might help. But again, it's always armored scales, and it's typically on woody plants, but it could be on trees and bushes and all different hosts. Okay. All right, so just some be on the lookouts. This is for March. It's fairly general. I don't know what the temperature is going to be like this March and from now until next session, so it's hard to really be specific. I'm going to kind of generalize. But of course, insects are going to start to wake up. It's starting to warm up. The days are getting longer. They're going to want to come out and be active. Solitary bees are going to start swarming the grounds and emerging from holes, creating, basically mating, going, grabbing pollen and nectar and making new nests. And they often do this in ground that is not covered with a lot of vegetation. Note that though they are bees, they are not aggressive. They're solitary bees. They are very very docile, and you really shouldn't worry about them. They are also very good pollinators and are very important for the ecosystem. Hibernation is over for many insects, so paper wasps may start emerging in your home and you didn't know that they were there. Stink bugs and ladybugs will do the same. These insects overwinter as adults. They will come into your home, and I mentioned this last fall, that you should maybe see the influx of them. This is the time of year when you're going to start to see them waking up and trying to leave where they've been hibernating. Inchworms, like the fall cankerworm, you'll probably start to see soonish. Also boxwood leaf miners. I took a video a couple years ago and it was right at the end of March. So I may hit on that again next month's bolo just to make sure. But when the new growth for the boxwood starts to occur, and I just saw some samples of very mature larvae that are about to pupate, these will emerge from the leaves. The females and males will mate. These little orange flies will swarm your boxwoods, and here's a female laying an egg in the leaf, or eggs in the leaf, to become little maggots that live in the leaf and feed throughout the year. And the scale insects are going to start to get active, so they're going to start to grow. They're going to start to resume feeding from over the winter and start in the next couple months. I'll warn you about some of the soft scales and some of the other scales that are going to start producing eggs and crawlers, and that's actually the best time to treat. Okay, so I think that's it for me. If you have any questions, let me know, but otherwise I'm going to turn it over to Mike.
Thanks, Matt. That is an extremely hard act to follow there. I don't have any cool videos to show or photographs that are quite sharp and nice, but we'll do what we can here, and let's see, I guess I should probably crank up the slideshow here and share the screen. Where is it? So hopefully everyone can see the question associated with the welcome slide here. How long have you been an Extension Master Gardener volunteer? So let me bring up the polling. Let's see, we're gonna need an A through E on this one. Now, if you're in a room with more than one person, choose the response, the lowest response. So we wanna know who the youngest one among you is. I noticed that a lot of folks are tuning in alone this time, which kind of shatters my whole concept of Extension Master Gardener volunteers getting together, putting the card table up, playing bridge, and then hearing Matt and me drone on in the background. But the good thing is it'll give us a more granular result to know for our questions like this. In this case, how long have each of you been? So I won't say struggle, but we always take into consideration the fact that we have new people coming in, so some things that we may have talked about before will be unfamiliar to the newer folks, and we try and do a balance there when we can. So I'll give that another few seconds while people are answering. And it's funny because it marks the highest response here as C, so as if that were the winner. Well, there's no right answer here, but it is interesting to note that of those who replied, fewer people answered this than answered your question, Matt, about the septibacillium and the scales. But anyway, we have a pretty even distribution here among the different groups of experience. So interesting, though, that 14% here, 12 of you are fresh Master Gardener volunteers. So welcome to the program to you. And thank you for your continued service to those who have been here for over 10 years now, the 19 who answered that way. Also, again, thank you to Charlotte for all the organization that she does to make this possible and things that she does off season to line up the guest speakers and so on and make sure that everything's working, the bells and whistles, and Janine too. Thanks, shout out to her for the technical support. All right, so quickly a few things. Not too much active this time of year in the disease department, plant disease anyway, but we can talk about a number of things that are going on, some not disease related, and I've showed this slide before, kind of taking the same line that Matt started with on cold injury. And when I first started working in the clinic back in the late 90s, I was surprised that we were diagnosing cold injury in August. Tom Kressel was doing that, and I asked him, and what he explained was that oftentimes with woody plants, the damage occurs, obviously the damage occurs in cold weather, but you don't see the symptoms until weather warms up and you start getting the stress of the summer, making it hard for the plant to keep up with that damaged lower stem. So this is not the same as winter burn here. When we're talking about woodies, and in this sense, we're talking about the lower portions of the stem, which are the last parts to go dormant in the fall and the first ones to resume activity in the spring. So they're susceptible and most susceptible to these early freezes and late hard freezes. Often it'll just be on one side of the plant and you see some degree of bark splitting. If it's older damage, you may see some attempt by the tree to the shrub to heal over. It's common on some things like Gardenia pittosporum, which are pittosporum, of course, marginally hardy in central North Carolina, boxwoods, edible figs, but also many other kinds of plants. I have noticed, though, we had a sample come in that you wouldn't consider a woody plant, snapdragon, that had very similar damage, which I do believe was from the cold as well. So you notice the bark splitting here on this stem, or the exterior portion of the tissue that has broken away there. In that same, from that same grower, we had some straw flower where the midrib had some breakage to it, some splitting. And I interpret that as another sign of cold injury. I'm a little shakier on it, but one thing you may see too related to cold is a separation of the epidermis from the lower mesophyll of the leaf, and you get kind of a silvery look to the foliage, and of course, just a burned or blighted look like you saw in Matt's photograph of his osmanthus at the top of the program. Here's another straw flower sample that came in with that one shown before with the cold injury. And the question is it just cold injury or is something else going on? And I'll go ahead and anticipate the answer here. Yes, there is something more here. This is in fact a case where we've got one of many cases where we got Sclerotinia blight, also known as white mold. And we've seen it so far this year in the clinic on cabbage, collards, and Brussels sprouts, in the nursery on candy tuft, which, interesting fact, that's in the same family as the brassicas. The straw flower that you saw there in the previous picture on pulmonaria, also in a nursery on phlox paniculata and a nursery just across the border in South Carolina, and also on lettuce in a greenhouse. So it's been an active year for this particular disease. I've talked about it before, but I don't think I've ever done a side-by-side comparison of Sclerotinia blight versus Botrytis blight. So we'll attempt to do that here. Another way to put this would be white mold versus gray mold, which are the two common names for each of these diseases. So white mold is caused by the fungus Sclerotinia sclerosiorum and gray mold by the fungus Botrytis cinerea. They are related, so you do have some similarities. They're both cool weather pathogens favored by excess moisture. They will both cause or can cause stem rot and the collapse of shoots. In addition, Botrytis will cause leaf and flower blight, fruit rots, and even cankers on rose canes. One thing about Botrytis is that it likes senescent tissue, so it will often get started on spent blooms and then from there work its way into leaves and other parts of the plant. And also another similarity, in both cases, these are spread by airborne spores, but we'll see an important difference about those in a moment. With white mold, as you might expect, one of the typical symptoms, as you saw in the previous photograph, is that dense white fungal mycelium visible on the plant surfaces. You might see some of that sometimes with Botrytis, but likely not. Likely if you see anything, which you may not, but if you see anything, it's more likely to be the fuzzy gray sporulation as you see in the lower right photograph here. With the Sclerotinia, the little survival structures called sclerotia are going to be fairly common once it's developed enough, and it doesn't take that long. They'll first be like white pills in a bad sweater and then harden up and eventually become irregular structures that the best comparison is they look a lot like mouse droppings. So you can see in the lower left photograph there, some of them just at the end of their development, they're turning black little lumps on the plant tissue. And in the middle picture, that's a knife blade on the left that's cut open the stem. That was a phlox stem, and the almost insect-like or again, mouse dropping-like structure that's been removed there at the bottom is the sclerotium from this fungus. The interesting thing about this is that the spore production is on time delay. So that sclerotium will have to spend some time down in the soil and then form a small, it's almost mushroom-like body called an epithecium from which the spores are released and discharged into the air. So that is one of the angles that we go for when it comes to control, is we want to make sure that we get all the dead plant material cleaned up and not have cull piles laying around, and to do crop rotation and things that will keep these from being in the soil for the next season. With Botrytis on the right, the sporulation is going to be directly on the tissue, and it's going to be that kind of grayish look. It's actually black or very dark conidiophores, and then the spores themselves are white, so the combination looks gray, and those spores again are easily distributed in the air. There will be sclerotia formed by this fungus as well, but you don't see them that often, and they would be attached directly to the host tissue, not quite as loosely associated. As far as management, well, I almost want to say with Botrytis, it's kind of a good luck with that situation. It's so ubiquitous, it's just everywhere. So if you have any kind of moisture and any kind of senescent tissue, you may have problems with it. But we can say a few more details about the management strategies against Sclerotinia. And it turns out that the North Carolina Agricultural Chemicals Manual, little hidden gem in there, there are some of these tables that have to do with cultural practices, not with chemical control at all. So this particular table is from this year's Ag Chem Manual in the vegetable section with beans. And you'll notice that the last column here is about white mold or Sclerotinia. And some of the things that you can highlight as either having good or excellent control for Sclerotinia include avoiding overhead irrigation, crop rotation, deep plowing — you may not be able to do that in the vegetable garden — destroying crop residue, encouraging air movement, increasing between plant spacing, that again to reduce the moisture, and way at the bottom, soil solarization, if you're willing to have that period of plant-free material for the hot weeks of the summer. Now, moving quickly, sometimes it is more than botrytis. You may look at some pansies that have blighted leaves this time of year and suspect botrytis, but if you see the whole crown going down, the whole plant melting away, then you've likely also got something like a phytophthora crown rot or a pythium root rot. So these are going to be favored by moisture, as Matt was talking about, some of the problems that we've had with the rain. And even in raised beds, which is one of your good strategies, you could still get some of these diseases. Another case of it's more than botrytis. This was a rose sample that came in from a nursery just across the border in South Carolina. There was some botrytis canker on the rose canes, which is not that uncommon. But it turned out there was another disease here, which was pretty interesting, but shouldn't have been unexpected. And I'm going to kind of flip things around here. I don't think I've ever asked a question this way in Plants, Pests, and Pathogens, where I've asked by the name of the pathogen itself. So here we'll do an A through D poll. Let's see. And those of you who may have tuned in before and have seen the name Diplocarpon rosei may remember what disease this causes. The photograph there shows you the two-celled spores. That's a micrograph. So you wouldn't see these even with the hand lens, much less with the unaided eye. But that's what the spores look like, kind of oozing out of the structure there, the fruiting body. But what is the disease caused by the fungus Diplocarpon rosei? Is it black spot, crown gall, downy mildew, or powdery mildew? So we'll give just another 4 or 5 more seconds here.
And you can just use your keyboard to select your answer.
Oh, that's nice. I didn't know that. So, good job. Diplocarpon rosei, also called Marcinina rosei, is in fact the black spot pathogen. Crown gall is a bacterial disease. It wouldn't be a fungus at all. Downy mildew is, you could call it a fungus. Technically, it is an oomycete, so not related to the fungi, and powdery mildew is the fungus. But the correct answer was, in fact, black spot. And the reason I bring it up is because we can see it on the canes. Now, I didn't have a good picture of it, a cane infection by black spot, but I've got one on bugwood here. And this is just a reminder that when we prune roses, and we should do it, and I'll say when in a moment, that dormant pruning is going to help reduce the amount of disease that we'll have in the spring. If you look at the Roses for North Carolina fact sheet that we have on the Extension website, you'll see the statement: most of the annual pruning in North Carolina should be done in the spring, just as the buds break dormancy. So in our area, buds are pretty much beyond that now. So some folks may still have it. But if you're pruning to remove disease material, then that takes priority over the timing. So if you do see that you've got diseased canes, even if they have broken bud, then you should still try and remove those. And I want to just take a moment to highlight the first part of this, the content.ces.ncsu.edu. That is our fairly new, let me just kind of highlight that here. Got a, that first part of it, content.csu.ncsu.edu. If you type that in, that is the portal for all of the NCSU Extension publications. And you can type in the search box there and find out pretty much anything that you would care to find among our Extension fact sheets and so forth. Another disease prevention strategy for this time of year is going to be mulching. They're out on campus doing that this week, and that will help for black spot, for example, if you've got some overwintering material there in the ground that you're covering up. Also for petal blight on camellias. So this is a good time to do that mulching. Just remember not to go overboard and get it too close to the main stems of trees and shrubs, and also to not go too thickly. And of course, avoid the volcano mulching. Another strategy for disease prevention this time of year is when you're planting your vegetable garden, of course, the rotation, but also think about your varietal selection. These seeds are of some squash that we grew at home this past summer. It's called pipián squash, and it's actually not for disease resistance, but because it was, it's a traditional Mexican type of squash. And my wife is from Mexico, for those of you who don't know me. And this has the wonderful characteristic of not being attacked by the squash vine borer. So that was a real nice add-on here. It's not that great a squash to grow as a mature winter squash, but it's delicious when you grow it harvested very young. And it's also got these seeds that can be toasted and eaten that way. One of the points that we had wanted to make sure to get across, Chuck Hodges in the clinic here was talking about this, and Matt as well, that with arborvitaes, we have had quite a few where there was no disease problem that would explain the situation. If you looked at this photograph, Lindsay Haynes Maslow is actually here on the faculty at NC State, but at her own home had a problem with arborvitaes, which since October, Chuck had been working on trying to figure out, and they tested twice for Phytophthora root rot. They looked for armillaria root rot, which is even a more common problem on arborvitaes, and there was nothing there. Also remember, or jot this down, that arborvitaes almost never have foliar diseases. I've seen one case of a true foliar disease on arborvitae in the last 11 years, so it's extremely uncommon. This is the reason why bringing or sending in just clippings of branches in arborvitae is not going to be helpful, unless it's because there's bagworms there, which you would see, or bagworm tie-offs, which you could recognize. So photographs and even branches are not going to be enough to diagnose arborvitaes. We're going to really have to have those roots in soil. And in some cases, we're going to need to wait until the tree is being removed, where we can look for armillaria under the bark at the base of the main stem or stems and in the largest roots. So it can be a little tricky. And in this case, clearly the plants had been struggling for a while. You can see, assuming that they were all planted the same size and at the same time, you can see the ones in the corner there are much shorter. So their growth rate was probably less. I doubt that they intentionally pruned them shorter. So there's some kind of a soil issue going on here there that's leading to the drying out of that foliage. And we're not exactly sure what. The soil parameter is a little bit of high pH, pH on the high side, but not something you could expect to cause this kind of damage. So the main lesson here is that sometimes it's not a disease, and in particular for arborvitae, we really need that complete sample of not only the foliage, but with the roots in the soil. And I used this trick question last year, and I'm going to use it again. What is causing this leaf spot? And I have, let's see. Oh, I see them in the chat box. There was a question. Yeah, the squash variety, that is called Pipian squash. I'll type it in here. And it is Cucurbita argyrosperma. Very good name, silver seeded. So this one was one I put on the program this time last year, just to keep people thinking outside the box, what was causing this leaf spot. It actually turned out that it was Phytophthora root rot in that case. So that's a wilting reaction, a problem because the root function is impaired. Very quickly, because I know that Charlotte has some further announcements for you, be on the lookout for March. We've already talked about the Sclerotinia stem rot on the crucifers. We mentioned Botrytis. I didn't mention the context of onions, but that would be an area to keep an eye on. Pansies and violas are one of the few flowers that we have in the flower beds this time of year. So not only the Botrytis blight, Pythium root rot that we talked about, but also black root rot, which it's been a good year so far. It was a good year last year for the production side of things. We didn't see much, but it's another possibility. Nutrient deficiency, as all this rain washes the nutrients out of the soil, that's another thing to keep in mind as a possibility. Snapdragon, some folks may be using that as a cool weather flower, and it does get Sclerotinia stem rot, so there's another host to watch out for. And of course, by now your liriope should be getting their annual haircut, so you don't have anthracnose carrying over to the new year. But Fusarium crown rot, that will take out not just the tips, but the whole plant. And turf grasses, fairy ring, any time of year, large patch, spring dead spot. Spring, that's not easy to say. Spring dead spot, as you see in the photograph, really is an infection that occurred in the fall, but that reduces the turf's ability to survive cold temperatures. So you get these areas that were winter killed in the Bermuda or in the Zoysia, and you'll start to see that as the grass begins to green up again in the spring, and then certain areas don't. And finally, another one that you could be looking out for would be some of the fungal leaf spots in your bluegrasses and in Bermuda grass. A lot of things you could be on the lookout for: trees and shrubs any time of year, Phytophthora and armillaria root rots, boxwood blight. We haven't seen that much of it in the last few months, but do keep an eye out. Camellia petal blight, felt fungus, Matt already talked about, Entomosporium leaf spot on our red-tipped petunias, if there are any left in the landscape, and then on the Indian hawthorns you see on the left. Black knot on cherries and plums will be prominently seen still while there are no leaves on. Could get some fire blight on pear coming in. And we'll have the first of our rust diseases showing up on cedar. The earliest one, the earlier the two important ones that we see is the quince rust, which doesn't produce the giant telial horns, but a more subtle swelling and the orange gelatinous mass, but not in the long horns on the branches of the cedars. Cold injury and frost damage, of course, and you may find a couple of vertebrate types of injury, sapsuckers and branch pruning by squirrels as we move into the next month. I will stop sharing, turn it back to Charlotte, and I'll see if there are any other questions.
Well, thank you, Mike. I don't see any questions coming in, but we'll just go through a few announcements and then we'll have a few minutes, maybe if anything comes in. I did want to hit one question that came in about henbit that I didn't catch before, and that was when I was mentioning if you pull the weeds up, don't just leave them laying in the garden because they could already have seeds formed. And the question was, as soon as the flowers appear, does the plant already have seed? And the answer is no, it does take a few weeks for the seeds to form, but for most of us, we don't catch them when they first start blooming. You know, they need to get quite a few blooms out there to really see them. So usually by the time we see them, there's a chance that seeds have already formed, or they have formed enough that if you pull the plant up and just leave it laying on the ground, the seed will continue to ripen. And that's a characteristic with quite a few weeds, is that they form seeds very quickly. From the time from flower to seed is only a few weeks, and that the seed can continue to ripen and fully mature on plants that have been hoed or have been pulled up. So that's part of what makes them weeds. So it's always a good practice to remove your weeds from the garden, because they could have seeds on them. All right, we're just gonna finish up with a few quick announcements. And first, just to say thank you. Thank you first to Matt and Mike, of course, for the wonderful information you shared and share every month. And thank you to every one of you out there for the amazing work you do. These facts and figures are from our 2019 annual report. I hope everybody's had the chance to see it. I'm going to drop some links into the chat box so you can check it out. But, you know, this is just amazing to look at the number of volunteers we have in the state, over 3,000, you know, the hours that are coming in, equal to 110 full-time employees. The contacts, you know, it's just amazing the work that's happening. And thank you to every one of you for being part of the Extension Master Gardener program. Also, a huge thanks to everyone who donated to the anniversary appeal for the Extension Master Gardener Endowment. We had record-breaking donations. In fact, we've never raised $10,000 in 1 year for the endowment. And this came both from individuals making donations, as well as people purchasing license plates or renewing their license plate. So remember, if you do have a Master Gardener license plate, every time you renew it or make that initial purchase, every year the $10 goes to the endowment. And then we had donations from groups, you know, local associations or Master Gardener local groups. So all of that is just tremendously appreciated. And the endowment itself, the principal remains forever, but we have interest that comes off each year that can help support growth of the program. And one thing that the principal is used for is our Search for Excellence Awards. And it's that time of year again. So we hope all of you are considering submitting a group project in your county for Search for Excellence. We are looking for projects that have a focus on learning, whether it's the volunteers are learning something or the public's learning something. So you're sharing information, people are learning, people are hopefully taking that information and doing something differently and adopting the recommendations we make. Those applications are due March 20th, and one of the links that was dropped in the chat will take you to, yes, learn more about Search for Excellence, take you to the webpage where you can download the application and the guidelines and get more information about it. So really hope to see many of you submitting applications on behalf of your county. And of course, the best way to stay up to date with everything that's going on with the state program, Extension Master Gardener program, is to subscribe to our email list. That link is also in the chat. And that is us for this week. So we just want to wish you all happy gardening until we meet again, which hopefully will be on March 24th, when we'll hear from Elsa and Meredith about how to operate a bee hotel. So thank you, everybody. I don't see any final questions coming in the chat, but if you do have anything, feel free to drop it in or unmute your mic and ask. Otherwise, wishing you all a wonderful week. Wishing you all a wonderful week. And I did see somebody asked if we can drop the email sign up again, so I'm going to pick that up and put it back in the chat. If you would like to subscribe to the email list, here is the link.
Thanks for everything, Charlotte.
There we go. Yes, thank you. Matt? Yeah.